you for the introduction, and thanks to the organizers for inviting me and giving me this opportunity. I added mortality here to the title because that will be relevant for the context. I have no conflicts of interest. So, this is lactose. It's the principal carbohydrate in milk. It is hydrolyzed by the enzyme lactase into its constituents, one molecule of glucose and one molecule of galactose. The galactose is then further metabolized through the Leloir pathway, eventually yielding another molecule of glucose. There are other pathways as well, but the Leloir pathway is the major one. The vast majority of the absorbed galactose is retained and rapidly metabolized by the liver, so it's only a small portion of the galactose reaching circulation. But of all the carbohydrates, why the interest in lactose? Well, I would say that much is due to this study, published by Mikkelsson and colleagues in 2014. They observed in a sample of 38,000 women followed for 20 years, a quite strong association between self-reported intake of non-fermented milk and mortality. And this association was much weaker in another sample of 45,000 men followed for 11 years. They also observed an inverse association between self-reported intake of cheese and fermented milk products and mortality. This publication got a huge amount of attention, as shown by this altmetric plot. However, the authors themselves rightly point out that there is an inherent possibility of residual confounding and reverse causation, and hence these results should be interpreted cautiously, which the media failed to do, apparently. The authors also suggest a mechanism for these intriguing findings, namely that the galactose component of lactose induces oxidative stress and inflammation. And they base this mainly on animal studies, where it has been observed that daily subcutaneous injections of galactose induces oxidative stress and inflammation. And the dose administered here is equivalent to about 1 to 2 glasses of milk under your skin daily. However, the authors in the paper also present some data supporting this hypothesis. In a subgroup of about 900 women, they find a weak association between self-reported intake of milk and a biomarker for oxidative stress. It's a prostaglandin metabolite. And in a subgroup of about 700 men, this association is weaker still. However, they also see a positive association between self-reported intake of milk and circulating interleukin-6 as a marker for inflammation in a subgroup of about 600 men. However, for some of these analyses, the exposure, the reported intake of milk, and the outcome, for example, IL-6 here, were measured 6 years apart. And for the galactose hypothesis, as we will call it, to be credible, there needs to be a difference in galactose content between fermented and non-fermented milk products, because that's what they base their arguing on. Thanks. So let's look at that. In this paper from 1976, researchers added a mixed yogurt starter consisting of the bacteria Streptococcus thermophilus and Lactobacillus bulgaricus to milk. And these strains of bacteria are two of the most commonly used lactic acid bacteria in the dairy industry. And what they found was that both the glucose and the lactose components were readily utilized and metabolized by the bacteria. However, the galactose was not utilized at all by these lactic acid bacteria. And they also did follow-up studies showing that when one of these commonly used lactic acid bacteria ferments intact lactose, the glucose is readily utilized. However, little, if any, of the galactose is metabolized. Rather, it's just excreted into the medium. So based on these early findings, we shouldn't expect too much of a difference in galactose content between fermented and non-fermented milk products. In a much more recent paper, these researchers compared the content of lactose and galactose in different dairy products. And the y-axis here shows the comparison with non-fermented milk. So here you can see that the lactose content in yogurt is about 60% of that in milk. And this result is neither novel nor surprising. However, the galactose content of yogurt was about 95% of that in non-fermented milk. So the galactose contents of yogurt and milk are basically the same. And for soured milk, the lactose content was about 80%, as was the galactose content. And the same was true for kefir. And the take-home message here is that it's important to consider the strain of bacteria used in the respective product before making assumption about the carbohydrate profile. However, the association between self-reported intake of milk and mortality has been replicated in another Swedish cohort, kind of. Here, about 100,000 middle-aged men and women were followed up for about 14 years, and it was found that a higher intake of non-fermented milk was associated with a 2-5% increased risk of mortality compared to a lower consumption of non-fermented milk. However, intake of milk was also positively associated with more smoking, less education, and less physical activity. So again, we have an inherent possibility of residual confounding. However, these associations were strengthened in a dose response analysis. However, in a sensitivity analysis, they found that the lactose could not explain this association between milk and mortality. Let's return to galactose for a while, because galactose is not just a waste product from lactose digestion. It actually has biological functions, one of them being the galactosylation of immunoglobulins. In fact, several autoimmune disorders are characterized by a reduced galactosylation of immunoglobulin G, and this reduced galactosylation is positively correlated with the disease activity. And we also have an endogenous production of galactose as assessed by stable isotope tracers. In this study, when they used continuous infusion of carbon-13 labeled galactose, they found that both galactosemic patients and healthy normal subjects synthesized gram quantities of galactose per day, and that this endogenous production was far exceeding the intake of galactose on a lactose-restricted diet. So even if you try to reduce your exposure to galactose by reducing lactose in your diet, you're still stuck with quite a substantial endogenous production. In this study, 14 healthy men completed two meal challenges in a crossover design. And the meal challenges consisted of either 800 grams of milk or 800 grams of yogurt. And the aim here was to see how much, if any, of the lactose and galactose that reaches the circulation intact. And as you can see here in blue bars, the lactose in circulation is higher after the intake of milk compared to the intake of yogurt. However, the absolute concentration is of course very small, as would be expected, reaching only about 0.02 millimolars. However, the circulating concentration of galactose is much higher after the intake of yogurt compared with milk. The galactose in circulation is barely detectable after intake of milk, whereas it reaches a concentration about 0.2 millimolars after the intake of yogurt. So this concentration is about 10 times higher than the lactose concentration after the yogurt intake. And I would say that this piece of data here doesn't really support the galactose hypothesis. Let's leave galactose now and return to lactose for a while. There are some other sources of dietary lactose, except for the obvious dairy products. For example, some sweet products, cereal products, and also some fruit and vegetables. However, the majority of lactose, of course, comes from dairy products. And within this dairy category, the majority of lactose comes from non-fermented milk, at least in the Swedish diet. So from an epidemiological point of view, the intake of non-fermented milk would be a rough estimate of the intake of lactose. So how does the overall picture look like when looking at the intake of non-fermented milk? This is a recent meta-analysis looking at self-reported intake of non-fermented milk and mortality. It's based on almost 270,000 individuals, and the analysis is per 244 grams of intake per day. As you can see at the very bottom, the overall result is extremely null, the relative risk being 1.00. And most of the studies are dotted about the line of unity here. It's really just one study that stands out, and that's the Mikaelsson paper I showed you in the beginning. Looking at cardiovascular disease from the same publication, again, we can see that the overall result is very null, the relative risk being 1.01. But how about type 2 diabetes? This is a very recent meta-analysis of meta-analyses and systematic reviews. And what you see here are the results for high versus low consumption. And it's also split by total milk, high-fat milk, and low-fat milk. And as you can see, there are some differences here. But as you also would know, high consumption and low consumption is not the same across populations. So the authors also performed dose response analysis. And as you can see now, there does not appear to be much of an association between self-reported intake of non-fermented milk and type 2 diabetes. However, if we instead look at yogurt, we can see that there is quite a consistent and inverse association between self-reported intake of yogurt and the risk of type 2 diabetes. Again, this is for high compared to low intake, but this picture more or less remains in the dose response analysis. So there appears to be clear differences between milk and yogurt for whatever reason, at least from an epidemiological point of view, and this is not a new finding. Now I will leave the evidence from self-reported intake data a while and instead talk about Mendelian randomization, which is a popular way of trying to assess causal relationships in epidemiology. When we look at an association between an exposure, for example, non-fermented milk, and a disease, there will always be confounding factors associated with both the exposure and disease that we cannot fully adjust for. Hence, there will always be an inherent possibility of residual confounding. However, one could instead use a genetic variant that is reliably associated with the exposure and at the same time is not associated with the confounders and not independently associated with the disease, meaning that any association between the genetic variant and the disease should be mediated through the exposure. And for our case here, we could use the lactase persistence genotype as an unbiased proxy for milk intake, because lactose intolerant people will likely drink less milk in order to avoid abdominal pain and diarrhea and other symptoms. However, also the Mendelian randomization design has limitations. For example, it gives no information on the type of milk, if it is whole milk or skim milk or whatever. And also there are multiple genetic variants that can be used, and there is always the potential for pleiotropy, meaning that the genetic variant may affect multiple traits. And also the strength of the genetic instrument varies across populations, as you can see here. The black bars represent the difference in milk intake between subjects being lactase persistent and subjects being lactase non-persistent. And this is the classical genotype now. And as you can see, for example, the Northern European countries, Finland, Sweden, Denmark, for example, there is quite a large difference between being non-persistent and persistent in milk intake, 1.8 deciliter per gram of milk. However, in southern European countries such as Spain and Italy, this classic genotype is more or less useless because there is no difference in milk intake across the genotypes. This is a very large study from Denmark, consisting of about 98,000 people, followed for about 5 years. And they used this classical genotype, and they could indeed see that there was a difference in milk intake between subjects being non-persistent and subjects being lactase persistence. And importantly, there was no difference in the intake of fermented dairy product here. However, there was no association whatsoever between this genotype and ischemic heart disease or myocardial infarctions, either when analyzed in a per allele way or when analyzed in a dominant model, and that was the same for both these outcomes. In a related paper, the authors also looked at the risk of type 2 diabetes, and again they found no association at all between genetically determined intake of milk and the risk of type 2 diabetes, the relative risk being 0.99. In another study within the PREDIMED, consisting of about 7,000 individuals followed for about 5 years, they used another genetic variant more suitable for this population, and they could indeed see that this genotype was associated with a differential intake of milk, and that was true across the whole 5-year period. However, this genotype was not associated with cardiovascular disease nor mortality, although this population is considerably smaller, of course, compared to the Danish one. Now we have talked a lot about epidemiology. Let's look at some interventional data. In this very recent publication, 100 Chinese women with obesity and fatty liver were randomized to consume either 220 grams of yogurt or milk per day for 24 weeks in an isocaloric parallel design. And here it was found that the consumption of yogurt led to reduced liver enzymes and liver fat. However, the liver fat was analyzed only in a smaller subgroup. The results for inflammation was a bit more mixed, with one inflammatory biomarker, TNF-alpha, was decreased after the intake of yogurt compared with milk, whereas other inflammatory biomarkers such as CRP, IL-6 and IL-1-beta were not different between the diets. Also, another marker for oxidative stress, MDA, was similar between the diets. However, a marker for gut permeability was reduced following the intake of yogurt compared with milk. And also, endogenous antioxidant enzymes such as glutathione peroxidase and superoxide dismutase were increased after the consumption of yogurt compared with milk. So there are differences here also in interventional designs, for whatever reason. In another quite recent study, 14 healthy men were randomized to consume either 400 grams of yogurt or 400 grams of milk per day for 2 weeks in a crossover design. And here, the authors could find no evidence of changes in fasting or postprandial inflammatory markers such as CRP, IL-6 and TNF-alpha. And now this gut permeability biomarker, LPS, didn't change either. So in summary, self-reported nutrient intake should be interpreted very cautiously because we will always have an inherent possibility of residual confounding. And the effects of lactose per se are very difficult, if not impossible, to disentangle because the majority of lactose that we consume comes from dairy products, also contributing with a lot of other nutrients and components. However, looking at self-reported intake of non-fermented milk, then we see that non-fermented milk appears quite neutral for cardiometabolic health and mortality. And based on the available evidence, I would say that the galactose hypothesis appears unlikely. And the Mendelian randomization method may be useful, however, it's important to acknowledge the limitations and handle them carefully. And we see clearly that there are differences between milk and yogurt, both when looking in epidemiology and when looking at randomized controlled trials. However, it's unclear why we see these differences, and my personal opinion is that the content of lactose and galactose has little, if anything, to do with that. So my overall conclusions would be that lactose intake from decent dairy is likely not a concern. Thank you.